Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, transgender athletes, what are the rules and what is fair?
I was always looking over my shoulder thinking, how would these people treat me if they knew that I was trans?
Anytime you have a trans woman athlete in an elite team, well, that's a place that a woman doesn't have.
Well, I am a woman, so I belong there.
I think it is really important for us to protect the female category.
We need to be breaking down barriers for trans people.
We need to be able to dialogue and not picking a side.
Thank you so much for being here. Roxy, you're a transgender woman from regional New South Wales. You played hockey for 10 years from when you were 16 years old, but you stopped when you were 26. Why?
Something didn't feel quite right, and it has taken me decades longer to look back and try and dissect that and understand that I really didn't like being in the male changing rooms. They were... I felt really uncomfortable there. I didn't like the smells or the sounds.
You stopped playing hockey for almost two decades. What was that period for you like without sport?
I stepped back from a lot of society. I had less friends than I should have. I didn't exercise. I've been overweight for most of my life. Not being able to play team sport, it really takes you away from community.
You started transitioning in your late 40s. How did people respond?
I had a bunch of people say, ah, that makes sense. Or, yeah, okay, I see that now. I did have some friends that didn't really take kindly to that, and some of my family really struggled with it as well.
2 years later, you started playing on a women's softball team. What was that like?
I actually didn't know whether I was allowed to play or not, so I ended up talking to the Australian Sports Anti-Doping Authority, as it was at the time, talking to the local organisation that was running the Masters Games, talking to a whole pile of people trying to work out whether legally I was allowed to play, until everybody said, yeah, you're fine.
You now play for East Lismore Hockey Club. How important is that team to your life?
I'm actually not sure if I'd still be around if it wasn't for them. They're all just so wonderful.
Caroline, you're 56. Sport has been a major part of your life since you were 4 years old. Why is competing so important to you?
It's been a big sense of my identity. It's always something I've been good at, with rugby and athletics and the other sports I did. My family were huge on playing sport when I was younger, and just a sense of community and fitting in with everyone. So that's why it was really important to me.
You took part in men's athletics and rugby union mm-hmm. until your 30th birthday, when you transitioned from male to female. Mm-hmm. What reception did you get when you started playing women's rugby?
Well, the first year, I had a coach who told me to just keep it quiet because otherwise I wouldn't make any rep teams. Yeah, and I had a really successful year. I was nominated for the Sydney Morning Herald Rugby Awards for one of the top six players in New South Wales. And then there was talk about me possibly being in the Australian team for the next World Cup. So that the first 12 months was just... it was like a real honeymoon period for me.
What was it like to have to keep it quiet?
It's very tough, because I was always looking over my shoulder thinking, how would these people treat me if they knew that I was trans? And I'm not sure if some had suspicions.
It took a year before your teammates found out you were transgender. How did they react?
At first it wasn't too bad, but it became worse as time went on, and then it just sort of... it went viral, you know. I was bullied by some teammates, and both club and rep level, and I was pretty much made a pariah. And in 2005, that was my annus horribilis. That was a really, really tough year for me, and it just was not an easy year to endure.
Did you continue playing after that horrible year?
Yes, I switched from Parramatta to Sydney Uni, and it was a lot better environment for me.
Deborah, as a professional weightlifter, you first competed at the Commonwealth Games in 2002. What was significant about that event?
The 2002 Commonwealth Games was the first time that women actually had the right to compete in weightlifting. Weightlifting was a core sport of the Commonwealth Games since 1950 for men. So as an 18-year-old, that was my debut at the Commonwealth Games, and I unexpectedly came away with 3 silver medals for Australia.
What did it mean for you to be able to compete at that level?
Oh, it was incredible. I had done athletics at a high level and just tried to basically be a better discus thrower by starting weightlifting, and then had the chance to actually start competing in weightlifting. And I just sort of went from strength to strength and competing at, you know, at the high level, and then to know that the Commonwealth Games was actually an option, it was very memorable.
Since then, you've become a bit of a legend in the sport. What have you gone on to achieve?
So following that, I made 2 Olympic Games, 2004 and 2008, which no woman has had the opportunity to do in weightlifting in Australia. And I also competed at 5 consecutive Commonwealth Games. So started in 2002 and went right through to the Gold Coast Commonwealth Games in 2018. I was also the first woman inducted into the Australian Weightlifting Federation Hall of Fame, which was a really special moment as well.
You were involved with the sport for 20 years. What does it take to reach that elite level?
A massive amount of hard work. You don't sort of see it as sacrifices at the time because, you know, I loved absolutely every moment of doing the sport of weightlifting. But, you know, there's a lot of kilometres that I drove from my house to the gym. I actually calculated that I would have been lifting up to 20 tonnes of weight every single training session, which really takes it out of you.
During the Commonwealth Games in 2018, you competed in your hometown. What was that like?
It was an amazing experience. That moment was just an incredible way for me personally to cap off a 20-year weightlifting career, to, you know, a great chance to be there with my coach, to say thank you really to my coach, my training partner, my family, my 2 daughters and my husband were there cheering me on. It was the first time that my entire family was able to come from all around the world and actually see me compete. So it was a really amazing moment for me.
At those games, you were up against transgender lifter Laurel Hubbard. How did you feel about that?
My experience of that was that it was very confronting for me. It was also very distracting for me in the competition. It was a historical moment, really, because there was such a lot of talk in the previous year and a half or so about whether this would actually happen, would the rules allow it and that sort of thing. There was a lot of discussion in the lead up to the competition. You know, this was capping off my entire career. This was supposed to be, you know, for me, a really, I guess, a really special moment for me, my family and the crowd that, you know, had come to watch me compete as well. So it was fairly confronting to line up on the stage and be sort of in that historical moment and be part of it, to know that, you know, I was competing against a transgender athlete. The one thing that I was asked from 6 months out from the games to this moment is, how did I feel about it? And I sort of wanted to have that moment for me as an athlete, as a woman, being the first person in Australian weightlifting to compete at 5 Commonwealth Games. You know, that was a record in itself, and I think that's what I wanted to enjoy in that moment.
Did you feel there were physical differences between you two?
I did feel in that moment that there was significant, not so much that I was at a disadvantage, but that the transgender athlete was at a physical advantage. That's definitely how it felt at the time, yeah.
So do you believe Laurel had an unfair advantage over you?
Yeah, I believe that there's so many different reasons why I feel that there was an advantage there, with not just the body size or the frame, the muscle mass, larger hands to grip the bar, larger feet to push and have force production on that platform. There was that advantage, a physical advantage from Laurel, yeah.
In your view, should transgender athletes like Laurel compete in female sports in general?
In my view, I feel that women should be competing against women, and that I feel that when there's such a disadvantage for women to have a transgender athlete compete, I don't feel that it's fair. And fundamentally, competition in sport is about a fair playing field. I feel that women and girls particularly need to be protected in the sense of having a fair playing field.
Holly, you're a political philosopher specialising in feminism. Do you think transgender inclusion threatens women's sports?
I do.
I mean, I guess a good place to start is to notice that trans issues aside, almost no one is contesting that we should have sex-separated sport. And I think that's out of recognition, right, that there are meaningful differences physiologically between male and female bodies, that there are issues of safety, fair competition, privacy, and more. Anytime you have a trans woman athlete in an elite team, for example, that's a place that a woman doesn't have. And it gets even more serious when it comes to things like scholarships, prize money, pathways into new competitions. So I think if you're a big advocate for women's sport and women's kind of full inclusion in sport, that really grates.
Earlier this year, Tasmanian Liberal Senator Claire Chandler proposed a bill which she believes is needed to protect women's sport. Let's take a look.
Tasmanian Liberal Senator Claire Chandler is attempting to garner support for her Save Women's Sports bill that would allow sporting organisations the option to exclude transgender women from competing in female sports.
My bill just ensures that women and girls have the right to access single-sex sport. Unfortunately, we're in a situation where, under current interpretations of the Sex Discrimination Act, women can be forced to play against males. And we all know that there are obvious fairness and safety implications if that's the case.
I support it, as Claire knows. I think it's a terrific bill, and I've given her great encouragement. I mean, Claire is a champion for women's sport, and I think she's been right to raise these issues in the way that she has. Well done, Claire.
So many women have contacted me with concerns about this issue, but they are worried if they speak publicly or even internally, they might face consequences at their club or at their place of work.
We invited Senator Chandler onto the show, but she declined. We also invited Catherine Deaves, the co-founder of Save Women's Sports Australasia and Liberal candidate in the upcoming federal election. She also declined to come on the show. We also asked 14 of Australia's top national sporting bodies to talk about their inclusion policies and the bill. All 14 either declined or did not get back to us. Holly, this appears to be a hot button issue. Thank you for coming on to talk about it. What do you think of the bill? Is it needed?
I think it's great and I think it's needed. Basically, the bill is just giving sporting organisations the ability to offer single-sex sports without facing legal challenge. They're not mandating single-sex sport. It just means that if a sporting body wants to have a single-sex competition, which would mean excluding trans women, they are able to. And this bill's actually quite moderate. I think that's pretty reasonable.
Mm. Caroline, what are your thoughts on the bill?
I think it's a storm in a teacup. There's very few trans women. There's 1% of us population. There's so few of us playing sport. And as far as our participation goes, yes, it's not a black and white answer. Like, we can't play, yes, we can. It should be a case-by-case basis. Obviously, I think in general sport, community sport, everyone should be able to play. Elite sport, of course, there's got to be rules and guidelines. You can't transition one day and play the next. But I just don't think it's required.
Jade, you're a Greens Party candidate who's been advocating against the bill. We were at a protest you organised. Let's have a look.
We are free.
Free to be.
Free to be.
Who we are.
Who we are.
We are more.
My name's Jade and I'm a trans woman. I'm 31 years old and my pronouns are she, her. Voting for trans rights is important to me because I want to stay alive. I was forced to go through the wrong puberty and I didn't get a choice in that matter. I want the next generation of trans kids to grow up knowing only support and love and affirmation. If this bill passes, they will be legally able to say, hey, sorry, you can't play with us. I was 7 years old and I was watching Sesame Street and I saw some girls my age doing karate and I thought I would love to be like them. So I told my dad and yeah, signed me up straight after. that was really positive for me was having that community. After I came to the conclusion that I needed to transition, there was a slow shift that just made me feel less and less welcomed. I was intentionally excluding myself from the male or female change rooms. My fellow practitioners weren't using my pronouns. One of the people that I thought was the most supportive of me told me that I just needed to accept that everyone would view me as a man in a dress. And that absolutely ruined me. That evening, I went home and I cried and I disassociated and I self-harmed. While I was having all these troubles with karate, I was coming along to the roller derby community events, and it just struck me what a kind and caring and connected community roller derby is. Every single person, no matter who you are, is welcome and has a place. That's probably what I think is the most important thing about sport. It's a way to stay healthy, it's a way to make friends, and it's just one of the best things in life, really.
Jade, what's your main concern with this bill?
So my main concern with this bill is that it is fundamentally flawed. It injects a definition into the Sex Discrimination Act of biological gender, which is inaccurate and misrepresents trans people. The immediate impact for me would be that the government of the country that I reside in had ruled that I am not a woman. And that is fundamentally rejecting my very existence as a trans woman, because trans women are women, and the psychological impact of that can't really be understated.
Robin, you're Tasmania's former anti-discrimination commissioner. Would this bill exclude people like Jade from playing women's sports?
Yes, without a shadow of a doubt. And not just competitive sport. It would exclude not only people like Jade from all levels of sport, all types of sport, whether it's social or competitive, irrespective of age.
What about concerns that this bill could extend beyond sports and prevent access to female support services?
I think that's a very real fear.
Holly, this bill has been labelled as transphobic by some. What do you think of that?
I think there's a big disagreement going on over the concepts of gender, and they're grounded in two very different ideologies. Of course, if you think the only relevant concept in the ballpark of gender or sex is gender identity, then the bill is going to look pretty transphobic to you, right? It's reinstating biological sex definitions, which were in and then were taken out of the Sex Discrimination Act. And it's wanting to give organisations the ability to offer services on the basis of sex, not gender identity.
Why does biology matter, in your view?
The fact that someone is born female should not determine her destiny ending up, you know, as a wife and mother or a service person for men. It meant her biology should not limit her opportunities. It doesn't mean there's no sex difference and any male can become female.
David, you're a world authority on testosterone and its effects on sports performance. How does testosterone impact the body?
Look, the male physical advantages in sports really stem from male puberty. Before puberty, boys and girls can compete equally, but after puberty, men have 20 to 30 times the production of testosterone compared to women. And this leads to larger and stronger muscles, bigger and stronger heart, bigger and more lung capacity, and longer and stronger bones, as well as a higher hemoglobin. And all of those things contribute to sports performance, to the improvement in sports performance.
What is the extent of these male advantages?
If we consider the times and distances, like throwing or jumping in athletics and swimming, the advantages that males have are between 10 to 20% in virtually all of those events. To put that into context, if you look at female world records in all the swimming and athletic events, every year men, hundreds of men, surpass those performances, and thousands of them do it over time. And the most telling thing is that at the age of 14 or 15, boys at that age, in early to mid-puberty, already surpass female world records, pointing out that it's male puberty that's so instrumental in that. So that makes it very unfair to have male-bodied athletes in female events.
How is unfair defined when it comes to sports?
Well, it's a subjective term, of course, but let's focus on the 10 to 20% advantage in athletics and swimming. The winning margin is less than 1%, and by that I mean the chance of winning a gold as opposed to missing out, getting a medal or missing out, getting into a final or missing out, less than 1%. There have been some recent interesting developments in athletic equipment, super running shoes and two decades ago super swimsuits, which produced 3 to 5% advantages, and they were banned by the sports federations as inherently unfair. So that gives an idea that 10 to 20% is certainly well beyond what's considered a fair, what is it, an unfair advantage. Look, it's also important to point out that stratification by sex to maintain fairness is not unusual in sports. Sports also stratify by age, by weight in boxing and weightlifting, by skill in judo, and by disability grade in Paralympics, all designed to maintain fairness at each level, each strata of those events.
Mayanna, you've played golf since you were 8 years old. You went through male puberty and started transitioning in your 20s. In 2004, you made history by playing golf in the Women's Australian Open. Do you think you had an unfair advantage?
I guess it probably depends on who's answering the question. You know, me getting into professional golf also was preceded by a good 4 or 5 years, you know, working through the ranks in amateur golf as well. And I was always very tentative. And then I was invited to join some local women's club teams. And so I did step into it cautiously, actually expecting to have an advantage. But when I was exposed to this, I saw I've got a lot of work to do. And it did take a lot of work before even getting to 2004 and playing a professional event.
Did you win any tournaments?
I had an 11-year touring career. And I didn't win any. I had a number of top 10 finishes, one or two second place finishes. That was it.
What are your thoughts on the Save Women's Sports Bill? Does women's sports need saving?
I think clearly yes. Something needs to be done. There is a very clear difference between people born male and people born female. You can see that walking down the street. And what's really concerning is now, from the original 2003 policy of the IOC, which had a requirement of surgery and 2 years of ineligibility. In 2015, the requirement of surgery was removed and less ineligibility period. Now it's moving more and more towards, you know, what's termed self-ID, where someone born male can just self-identify as female.
Is there a cost to inclusion?
Well, of course, there's a cost to women and girls in sport. And, you know, that's not okay.
20 years ago, you successfully lobbied to overturn international golfing rules regarding transgender players so you could play on the women's tour. By supporting the bill, wouldn't it also stop you now from playing women's sports? Like, how would you feel about that?
Well, potentially it could. Obviously, I'm in a bit of a tenuous position where I'm someone that's enjoyed an 11-year professional career. It's finished. Sport isn't part of my life anymore. As I understand it with the bill, is that it's not going to exclude explicitly transition women or transgender women in sport. I never really agreed that an air of fear of litigation or backlash really helps us move forward in society. I think everyone should be permitted to make reasonably fact-based and rational decisions rather than being forced into a position that, well, we're going to have to make these rules, otherwise they're going to sue us.
And how many times has Caroline beaten you?
In what, the one and the two? Never.
Okay.
Sorry.
She would it have made a difference if you had known Caroline was transgender?
Absolutely no.
What if Caroline had beaten you or continued to beat you?
I would have just trained harder.
Jane, you're a dual Olympian and Commonwealth Games gold medalist. You were also ranked number 2 in the world for heptathlon. How much of your life was dedicated to elite track and field competition?
I think my life probably only reflects the life of every one of my female teammates. 24/7, it's worse than being a workaholic because it is everything you eat, everything you drink, every minute that you sleep. And it is all-encompassing, and people often even ask me now, would I like to compete in Masters? And I'm like, I'd rather have a hot poker in the eye than ever compete again.
It's that hard.
It's very intense. It's a really unbelievably intense way to live. And I competed through a kind of drug-fueled era as well. I competed against a lot of women that were taking artificial testosterone and other things that masculinised them for their advantages.
Recently, the president of World Athletics said the integrity and future of women's sport was very fragile, to quote, due to transgender athletes. What do you think about Sebastian Coe's comments?
I certainly agree, and I think that truly on every female elite athlete that I've spoken to would agree. Whether they've got enough courage or opportunity to speak out without feeling they're going to be vilified, I think, is another situation. I think it is really important for us to protect the female category and to try and almost define the female category as having no male advantage. You don't want to stand on the start line after having had those 15 intense years or 10 intense years or whatever it happens to be and feel that there is an unfair advantage before you even start the race. It's something we've fought for so long, to have that fair platform, that fair stage for women to compete.
Do you think women's sport in Australia does need saving, as Senator Chandler's bill suggests?
Well, potentially it does. There's been examples like Leah Thomas in the US that was an elite swimmer and is now winning women's races, and the recent case of the junior British record holder in cycling wanting to cycle against women as well. And I think we are at a very interesting turning point in sport, and certainly in women's sport. And if it is not dealt with collectively, I think the integrity of women's sport is absolutely under question.
Deborah, what do you think about this notion? Does women's sports need saving?
Absolutely. Women and girls need to be protected. We need to do what we can now to make sure that that we've got fairness in place for women and girls.
Jane, how important is this concept of a fair playing field in elite sports?
Well, I think that's the basis of sport. We don't have a 100-kilogram weightlifter lifting against a 50-kilogram weightlifter because it's not fair. I think we need to look at other solutions that can absolutely be inclusive, but I don't think inclusiveness in this case can override fairness, because fairness is the fundamental philosophy that underpins competitive sport.
World Athletics currently requires transgender women to suppress their testosterone levels for 12 months before they can compete. Do you think that's fair?
That is a question that needs to be asked to the scientific experts.
Ada, you're an endocrinologist. You specialise in hormone treatment. In some women's sports, transgender women are required to lower their testosterone levels before they can compete. Why is that?
So testosterone is one of the main drivers of muscle mass and muscle strength. And so some sporting guidelines require testosterone levels to be lowered.
How do you lower testosterone?
So there's several ways we can lower testosterone. We can lower the secretion, so lower the production of testosterone with medication, testosterone blockers. We can block the effect of testosterone, so we don't lower the production, but we block whatever testosterone is circulating from acting in the body. Or we can remove the source, so we can do surgery and remove the testicles to reduce testosterone levels.
And how does lowering testosterone impact our bodies?
It has quite profound effects. So in transgender women, we typically not only lower testosterone, say, from a typical male range of perhaps 20 nanomoles per litre to the female range, which is typically less than 2 nanomoles per litre, we also raise the estrogen levels. And when we do that, we see that muscle mass reduces, fat mass increases. We see dramatic changes in hemoglobin. you may have heard of Lance Armstrong in the past, doping by trying to increase his hemoglobin to increase his aerobic fitness and endurance. And so hemoglobin, after we start feminising hormone therapy, reduces from the typical male range to the typical female range. It's not just muscle strength. There's aerobic fitness and there's stamina. I lead a transgender health research group. And working with the Institute for Sport and Exercise at Victoria University, we're about to start a research study examining this. And I agree we need to make decisions based on evidence. And we don't have a lot of evidence at the moment.
Roxy, how has lowering testosterone affected your body and your performance?
It demolished it. Not having any testosterone has massive effects on your body.
Joanna, you're a researcher and former top-ranking distance runner. You're also a transgender woman. After you transitioned in 2004, what did you notice about your own running times?
After 9 months of hormone therapy, which was testosterone suppression plus addition of estrogen, I was running 12% slower, and that's the difference between serious male distance runners and serious female distance runners. So I had lost my complete male advantage with 9 months of hormone therapy.
And this was because you were suppressing your testosterone levels?
Mostly. Certainly the addition of the estrogen has a little effect too, but it's largely because of testosterone suppression.
This observation prompted you to research and publish the first peer-reviewed paper on how hormone suppression affects trans women athletes. What did your study in 2015 suggest?
I looked at race times, 200 race times from 8 transgender distance runners before and after hormone therapy. And so if we used an equivalent comparison method, the trans women were no more competitive collectively after transition in the women's event than they had been prior in men's distance running. It's important to note that this observation is only true for distance running. It's only true for this small cohort of 8 people. So it was a very, very limited result, but there was nothing else like it.
Did your study suggest that there were any advantages?
Well, the study itself was looking at distance running, but it is undoubtedly true, and I have spent much of my time in the years since looking at trans women's athletic performance. And there is little doubt that trans women will maintain performance advantages even after hormone therapy. On average, transgender women will be taller, bigger, and stronger even after 2 or 3 or 5 or 10 years of hormone therapy. And those are advantages in many sports. However, trans women will also have distant advantages too. Their larger frames are now being powered by reduced muscle mass, reduced aerobic capacity. That can lead to disadvantages in things like recovery and quickness and endurance. And so there's this balance of advantages and disadvantages. And the last thing I would like to say is we allow advantage in sport. We let left-handed people compete against right-handed people in many sports where there is advantage. But as people have said before, we don't allow overwhelming advantage. We don't have big boxers competing against little boxers because there's no meaningful sport there. So I agree that we have to have, at the elite level of women's sport, meaningful competition. And it's still not definitively known whether testosterone suppression in trans women will result in meaningful competition between trans women and cis women in all sports.
David, does hormone therapy that suppresses testosterone get rid of the natural advantage males have?
It's important to keep in mind what we're talking about is an unfair physical advantage, so the objective is to eliminate it, not just to partially reduce it. But complete testosterone suppression has now been shown in a number of studies not to fully nullify the advantages of males in physical aspects for up to 3 years. Suppression of testosterone is partially effective. It won't change bones. They'll remain longer and stronger. Hemoglobin will change, but the key things, muscle, heart and lungs, virtually don't change, or they change very little, maybe 10 to 20% reduction, but 80% of the male physical advantage remains. So it's virtually incomplete and nowhere near completely reversing male unfair advantage.
Does the current research support transgender women competing in women's sports if they suppress their testosterone levels for a certain period of time?
The key thing is whether the unfair male advantage is removed over a certain time, and the answer is there is no duration which removes the unfair male physical advantage of male-bodied athletes in female events. The data shows that you can get some reversal, but really nowhere near complete, and therefore there remains an unfair advantage.
Joanna, what do you think about David's comments there?
I certainly agree with David that not all the advantage will be eliminated. I would suggest that trans women in many areas will lose 10 to 20%, not of their advantage, but of their overall capacity, which is in many cases the difference between male and female athletes.
Last year, the International Olympic Committee made significant changes to its transgender inclusion guidelines. What are they now?
The current framework is very inclusive based. It's a 10-point framework, and the first three points all suggest that inclusion is of utmost priority. I think points 5 and 6 in their framework are very interesting. Point 5 says that there should be no presumption of advantage with trans athletes. And point 6 says that there should be no restrictions put on trans athletes until there's robust, peer-reviewed, sport-specific evidence that suggests that there is overwhelming advantage. And I would like to say that I disagree with both points 5 and 6. And at elite levels of sport, I think it is absolutely justifiable to put restrictions on trans women, and that may go beyond testosterone. World volleyball restricts each national team to one trans woman. I think that's perfectly reasonable. However, when we're talking about recreational sport, where most people play, I think we should just let people play.
Mayanna, what's your view on surgery and testosterone suppression?
Well, if someone has gone through male puberty and has competed in elite pro-level sport or Olympic-level sport as a male, I think if they transition, that should preclude them from competitive women's sport. The reason being is that someone having been male and being a top-level sport has made maximal use of extremely high levels of testosterone that no woman will actually ever have an ability to do.
Caroline, as an athlete who has undergone testosterone suppression and testing to compete in women's sports, do you think it's fair you had to do that before you could play?
Absolutely.
Jackie, you're a Masters world champion in the 100 and 200 metre sprints. You trained and competed against Caroline. Did you realise at the time she was transgender?
I had no idea. I think I knew Caroline for close to 12 years and just saw her as Caroline, competed virtually every Saturday, Sunday against her in the 1 and the 2, and knew that it would always end up with the same outcome. I'd beat her in the 1 and the 2 and the 60.
And how many times has Caroline beaten you?
In what, the 1 and the 2? Never.
OK.
Sorry.
She owned me.
Would it have made a difference if you had known Caroline was transgender?
Absolutely no.
What if Caroline had beaten you or continued to beat you?
I would have just trained harder.
Rosalind, as a sports physician and researcher, you have been involved with elite-level athletes for more than 20 years. You were commissioned by the UK government to research and then help develop their national guidelines for transgender inclusion in sport. What were your findings?
The consultation showed that everyone in sport wants everyone to be able to do sport. Right. It's a universal perception. But there are polar opposite views of how that might be achieved. Similarly, the scientific research shows that there remains residual advantage in strength, stamina and physique in trans women. The conclusions that were drawn by the sports councils were that there could not be achieved a balance between inclusion, fairness and safety.
In sports, is it possible to be inclusive of everyone, like gender, religious, cultural or ethnic groups?
Yes, it's possible to be inclusive, but as we know from the history of sport, we've shown that you include people by making categories. And so by having different categories and different opportunities, and the sports councils were very keen to see that sports broaden their offering so that people have places in which to partake of sport and to do well in sport and to enjoy sport and to feel safe and comfortable in sport, that those different cultural aspects need to be respected and that we have places for everyone to be part of sport.
Maiana, should inclusion be the priority in sport?
Of course, inclusion is important. One of the complexities, I think, is the vast majority of people come from outside of an elite sport perspective. And obviously, we all like to live in an inclusive society with equal opportunity for everyone in the workplace, in society. And of course, I don't think anyone would expect anything less. But sport is different. Sport relies on physical ability. That's what it's about, and it's competition. That physical ability is determined by one's biological sex, whether it's male or female. So you can't just have inclusion as the main objective because you've got to consider the physical aspects. And unfortunately, at some point, someone is going to be excluded and they'll need to be based on that physical ability.
Mm-hmm. Damien, you're a PhD researcher specialising in sports ethics. Outside the nuances of the debate, are sports fans ready to see transgender women on the podium?
Well, that's the ultimate question. Every year or so, we have a high-profile example of where a transgender woman has won something. We have sporting organisations sitting there wringing their hands as to what they're going to do and whether or not they need to adjust their own policies.
Holly, do you think you could accept a trans woman winning at women's sport?
No. I mean, I just would always be worried about the woman whose place was taken by the trans woman athlete.
In Brazil, we have a lot of events just for the trans community who plays volleyball. And I wish that Australia could also provide this sort of event because it's great. I would love the trans community come and play volleyball.
If I hadn't have been there, my neighbor's kids would have come home from school to find their mother dead on the kitchen floor.
I don't think I did anything wrong.
I will regret that day for the rest of my life.
And what did the police then do when the intruder presented himself to hospital?
My grandfather faced the very real prospect of being charged and tried.
Laws would benefit from an amendment that took into consideration home invasion.
Volleyball has been my life since I was an 8 years old girl growing up in Brazil. Volleyball gave me the opportunity to play in a sport, make friends, get into the better education. Without volleyball, I would not be where I am today. 5 years ago, I came to Australia to live, and then I realized when I moved to Australia that volleyball is a small community sport here. My name is Nicole, and I love volleyball. I started the Northern Beaches Mermaid Group because I want to make sure that all the girls and women have the same opportunity that I had. Northern Beaches Mermaids Volleyball is one of the few women-only group playing here in Australia. We do need to be fast, and we have to have strength. It is a lot of physical contact. The difference between male volleyball and female volleyball is that we have the net that is 21 centimeters lower. There is a lot of debate about the transgender women come to play with us. All clubs in the community level want to have some clear guidelines. We are not professional athletes. We're just people from the community who want to have fun after work. We don't have the resources to test the level of the testosterone. So we need to find a solution to everyone to be included. In Brazil, we have a lot of events just for the trans community who plays volleyball. And I wish that Australia could also provide this sort of event because it's great. I love the trans community come and play volleyball. The community sports definitely need more guidance to provide the balance between fairness, safety, and inclusion.
Nicole, we've been talking a lot about elite sports, but what issues do you see at the community level when it comes to transgender inclusion?
I truly believe that the main issue that we have is the lack of communication between the organizations, the clubs, the community, and the players. And as a result, we do not have clear guidance about what we can do to be more inclusive in sports.
How do you think your sport can balance fairness and inclusion?
We want everyone to come and play with us. I would feel terrible myself if I could not allow a transgender person to come and play in the community sport level, because community sports should be there to everyone to play. But we do need to have a clear guidance. Mm. It's not about picking a side and say if you are for or against people come and play with us. And for that, we do need to talk. We need to be able to dialogue and not picking a side.
Rosalind, you worked with the UK government to develop guidance for transgender inclusion in sport. The three options that were proposed were to prioritise transgender inclusion, to protect the female category and open category, that's number two, or three, universal admissions, which was basically open to everyone. How are these recommendations working in the UK?
It's early days. The options that are there are to address the different priorities and for sports to choose the way forward. Mm. They're not exclusive, so the sports can offer different versions within their own sporting environment and have different options at different levels of sport or even in different competitive models. The sports councils are working with the sports to develop protocols and in particular to look at the universal sport option, which is a sporting competition whereby the requirement to define yourself by your sex or your gender is removed. Mm. So that there would be modified rules and perhaps modified scoring and that people can join in sport together. I know this is already happening in Australia. Mm. So there are versions all around the world where people are understanding that as society moves and changes, we need to meet this challenge by being creative and actually presenting options which are probably going to be the future of sport.
Mm. Roxy, you were involved in developing Australia's own inclusion guidelines at the community level a few years ago. Do you think the guidelines are sufficient?
I do. There's a balance to be sought there. And look, I'm a community sport advocate. I will never understand elite sport. I've never had that drive or commitment or ability to want to do that. So I think the guidelines for community sport for Hockey Australia are quite good, yeah.
Mm. Ada, you work with the transgender community. What's the participation rate in sport like?
I see and treat transgender people every day. I've treated hundreds, if not thousands, of transgender people. They're not participating in sport. Mm. Human Rights Commission research study in 2017 found that in high school students, 70% of girls participated in sport. And if we broke it down to sexually diverse people, LGB individuals, it was 30% participated in sport, but the participation rate for transgender girls was only 12%. Mm. And if you think about that, you know, trans people are comprised perhaps 0.5% of the general population. Only a third of those would be transgender women. There are going to be very few people out there playing sport. And I know from my research that trans people have alarming rates of depression, anxiety. You know, 70% or more have depression. Mm-hmm. They also face higher risks of heart attacks and strokes. And trans people need the physical and emotional benefits of exercise and sport. And at the moment, trans people fear going to the change room going outside and participating and exercising. And we need to be breaking down barriers for trans people to reap the benefits of exercise.
Mm-hmm. Holly, given those low percentages, are concerns about transgender inclusion in sport valid?
Trans identification is increasing, especially among the younger generations. So even if we might be seeing quite small numbers of people now, I don't think that would be a reasonable projection of the future. I don't think women should be asked to move over to make space for the kinds of concerns that Ada mentioned. I mean, they're really important concerns, but why is it always women that are being asked to give things up and make space? Why not the open competition? Why not some other solution?
Jane, this is clearly such a complicated issue. Do you think we'll be able to draw a line under it anytime soon?
I think the danger, if we don't, is the threat to, or the threat to the integrity, for want of a better word, that we've already spoken around, to the women's category. I don't think that there is as much of a threat to the community side of things, but certainly to the women's category. And I absolutely, in my heart of hearts, think that everyone should have a right to do sport. Everyone. I don't care what colour you are, what race you are, what biological sex you are, but I don't think that it's within the women's category. And I think that the findings and the recommendations that have come from Roz's research are perhaps those areas that we need to explore more and we need to explore quickly.
Jade, you left karate a few years ago after participating for over two decades. Do you think you will ever go back to it?
I feel like I wouldn't feel welcome because of the level of transphobia that currently exists, particularly around combat sports. I see that they don't view me as a woman. They view that if I get a medal, that's taking a place from a woman. Well, I am a woman, so I belong there. But I'm excluding myself because I know that's not how other people see me, and that's what needs to change.
Jade, thank you. Thank you to you all for your participation tonight. That's all we have time for. Thank you for watching. Dateline is next.